disturbing twist in the Bondi attack, with claims Joel Couchy stalked other shopping centres before deciding to embark on a stabbing spree at Bondi Junction. This is how it all unfolded. The bloodbath in Bondi began at 3:20 on Saturday afternoon. Joel Couchy drew a long blade from his backpack and started his rampage on level 3 of the shopping centre. He stabbed multiple people before making his way to level 4. As he climbed the escalator, he was confronted by a man with a bollard. It was on this level he attacked several innocent shoppers, leaving carnage between Meyer and David Jones. He went to level 5 next, bystanders scrambling to get out of his way, while a man put himself between the killer and his children. His rampage would soon be over, Joel Couchy hunted by Inspector Amy Scott and 3 civilians who chased him down, armed with chairs. 25 long minutes after the terror began, it would end with Amy Scott opening fire and stopping a murderer in his tracks. So the attack has raised serious concerns about the security of public spaces. Let's bring in security expert and former Westfield security manager, Dr. Phil Boss. Thank you for your time, Phil. Appreciate it. Can you walk us through the current emergency security guidelines at spaces like Westfield malls?
Thank you, Carl. The 3 key words are time, range and practice. And the current doctrine is known as the Active Armed Offender Guidelines for crowded spaces. And that's produced by the Australian New Zealand Counterterrorism Committee. And the 2 aims of this guideline are to reduce the time in which an offender can perform his actions and to reduce the range of motion in which he can act over. And so you would have seen from your presentation that you just showed clearly how much time and the distance the offender could travel. And the protocol requires that shopping centre management, security staff and shopping tenants come together with rehearsed practices to reduce that time and reduce that range of action, and that reduces casualties. They're the current guidelines.
They're the guidelines. So how do you think it rolled out?
Well, it was a long time for action and it was a long range. So clearly there are significant casualties. It could be done better. And what's required is to make sure that security staff and tenants know their responsibilities and are not facing these incidents for the first time. So practice, coordinated practice with local police and the 3 parties, security staff, shopping tenants and management of the centre, need to be regular so that these things are muscle memory and don't have to be thought about and solved on the fly.
This is a horribly difficult circumstance and we appreciate all the difficulties that Westfield's going through. However, we are going to reopen the shopping centre at some point. There are other shopping centres around the country, thousands of them. How is any shopping centre and public gathering made safe enough to prevent this from happening? But can we limit the fallout with the correct level of response?
Yes, so one finds that if you do these rehearsals and you apply these techniques as opposed to a vacuum of practice and no knowledge, that the reduction of casualties is significant and the effects are very worthwhile. For example, if the tenants are aware that shoppers can't necessarily evacuate and need to find safe refuge to shelter in place and stay safe, if they know that's their responsibility, then they'll put physical barricades such as closing their stores and make options available to the shoppers. That makes a significant difference to the range of motion which the offender can operate on. If that allows the security staff to know that the partnership role is undertaken for the shelter and they can deal with the more close proximity of dealing with the offender, summoning police, and not have to worry about the more global scale. So that coordination does make a big difference. And we've seen that in many times where organised bodies come together and mitigate the injuries and casualties by coordinated, practiced action.
All right, let's hope those conversations are going on now. Appreciate your time. Thank you. Well, we'll never fully understand what led Joel Couchy to commit the heinous act of taking 6 lives at Bondi Junction. We heard from his parents yesterday who have tried to paint the picture.
I'm loving a monster. To you, he's a monster. To me, he was a very sick boy. He wanted a girlfriend and he's got no social skills and he was frustrated out of his brain.
This is a parent's absolute nightmare when they have a child with mental illness.
I took 5 US Army combat knives off him when I brought him up from Brisbane. He called the police, you see, and accused me of stealing his knives.
Hard to make sense of the mind of a killer, isn't it? A criminal psychologist, Tim Watson-Munro, joins us now live from Melbourne. Tim, good morning to you.
G'day,
Carl. Well, give us your thoughts on the whole saga.
Well, I initially wondered whether it was madness or badness. It would seem that it's actually both. Mm. There's a diagnosis of schizophrenia, but he's also a person who is clearly planning this crime. I understand that Google traces have indicated that he was looking up how to kill people, how to acquire knives, and as the footage clearly reflects, there's planning here, there's an intention, obviously, to kill people, and sadly, five of the six people who were killed were women, so there was a misogynist element to it as well, Carl.
It changes the way we look at it, doesn't it?
I think it does. It doesn't change my view, however, about the need to put in more resources for mental health in the community.
I agree.
He was homeless, living rough. As you've discussed, as we've all discussed in recent times, there's a housing crisis in Australia, in Sydney and Melbourne. And so you have a combination of somebody with a mental illness, not getting adequate treatment, probably not properly medicated, and living in his car and becoming increasingly angry. So that said, most schizophrenic people, in fact, are not dangerous to others. It's generally about 1 in 14 million that are killed by a random schizophrenic act.
It's the unknown, isn't it? And who's to say who's going to do what at any particular time, and that's hard to plan for. Is there anything that you can see or glean from what you've seen over the last few days in analysing what happened that could have, should have been done better?
It's very hard to predict. I mean, there's so many homeless people. Sadly, there's a lot of homeless, mentally ill people on the street.
Yeah.
To be able to predict this type of crime, I think, is virtually impossible. I think the whole thing's about prevention, getting people into treatment, and ensuring that they comply with treatment may assist.
Would someone like that be, if they'd had more security in place, even armed security, even though that doesn't exist at the moment but could do down the track, would that, is that likely to prevent someone or make them less likely to perpetrate a crime like that?
I think that it's unlikely to assist. I mean, I would personally be against having metal detectors in large shopping centres. If somebody's keen to kill others, they'll find a way to do it. And that's the sad reality.
Look, I think the whole of Australia, and particularly in Sydney right now, is dealing with a lot. There's a lot of temperature. And that doesn't seem like it's going to abate anytime soon. We saw this knife attack last night in Western Sydney. It does put everyone on edge. And how do we protect against something like that? And what do we do with the public confidence now?
I think it's a very good question with respect. And I think as a nation, we are suffering vicarious post-traumatic stress.
Definitely.
I've spoken to random people in Melbourne yesterday who were saying, I don't feel safe going to a shopping centre. I don't know if I want to go for a walk with my baby. I reassure them. I think the best thing is to do what we're doing, talk about it, cut it down to size, and try and resume a normal life as quickly as possible. That will help.
Very good, Tim. Appreciate it. Thank you so much for being with us.
It's always a pleasure. Thank you.